Let's welcome Uma Dhimal and Krishna Gautam to perform a dance. It's a welcome song.
Thank you. and gentlemen, I hope you enjoy that wonderful dance, the Nepali dance. We are going to be your MCs tonight. And I would like to introduce myself, which is I'm Zalko Klipik, and I'm the president of Finding My Voice.
And my name is Sneha Priyanali, and I'm the vice president of Finding My Voice.
So let us begin with introductions. Let's have a few words from Mr. Rex Scott.
Thank you, Zelka. Thank you, Snehapriya. I want to welcome everybody to this outstanding event that is an annual source of both joy and pride for everybody at Catalina, but especially the students who have worked so hard all year, not just this week, to prepare for this event. I wanted to take this opportunity before I make some welcoming remarks to welcome some dignitaries in the audience. We're honored that they are here. First, the clerk of the TUSD Governing Board, Ms. Christelle Ann Foster. And Governing Board Member, Mr. Cam Juarez. And I believe we also have with us tonight the Director of Transportation for the Tucson Unified School District, Mr. Paul Larson. And if I'm missing anybody, let me know. Okay, thank you. You know, last year when the Finding Voice students put out a book, the book was entitled, "The Cover is Not the Book." And that title is instructive to all of us in so many ways, because it can be very easy and very tempting to judge our fellow human beings based just on superficial qualities, what we think about them or what we see about them the first time we encounter them. But when we challenge ourselves to get to know the people in our lives at a deeper level, we find that everybody has gifts and values and attributes to offer that enrich our lives and make this world a better place. And it can be very easy not only to judge our fellow human beings that way, it can be very easy to judge places using very narrow gauges. And I think one of the things that we have to do at Catalina is make more of an effort to make sure that our community knows exactly what we do here, exactly what we offer here, and exactly how many students we serve from so many different cultures. Over 40 languages and dialects are represented on this campus. We have the highest percentage of students who are homeless and displaced of any of the TUSD high schools. Over 80% of our students qualify for the federal free and reduced lunch program. This is a school that strives every day to meet the needs of students who must leave here with a high school diploma to have the kinds of lives that they hope to have in their futures. And I am very honored to be the principal. I am indeed blessed to work with the most talented and caring staff in all of TUSD. And I'm truly honored and humbled to be working with the students who will be presenting to you tonight. Thank you all very much for being here.
Josh. All right, welcome everyone. So excited. Tonight's program is going to be amazing. So we're going to keep this really short. A few thank yous. First of all, the ELD teachers, who I cannot see at all, could stand up and be recognized. We want to give a big shout out to our ELD department. Thank Mr. Scott and Mr. Barry, you're in here somewhere, and Mr. Madrid for all of your support for our work and for the work that we do with these students. Yeah. I want to thank Bonnie Morlock, our incredible tech person back there, and James Lucas, who's helping. Thank you guys. I want to thank Ms. Susan Curtis. and Meg Riley and Mary Cassidy for coordinating food and other things for tonight. And then I'd like to thank just a few of our community partners. The beautiful book that we are celebrating tonight was printed by Betts Printing, and they are an incredible local print shop that is so generous with us and does a beautiful job every year, so I want to give a shout out to them. The Catalina Alumni Foundation, many members are here. They are also very generous and supportive of everything we do. Thank you. Josh Schechter, thank you. All of our volunteers really make this work possible, and I know Runa is here tonight. Sam and Gretchen are not able to be here tonight. Claire Pirtle is here. If we could give a round of applause for our volunteers. Thank you so much. Again, a welcome to Cam and Christelle. We're very glad you're here tonight. Thank you for that. We have a number of Finding Voice and Catalina alumni. Can you stand up for a moment? Graduates of our school, students who've gone on to other amazing things. Thank you for being here. Some of you are shy, I see you, it's okay. And most importantly, I want to say thank you to the students. You've worked really hard this year. You're about to put on an amazing show, and thank you to the families who are here to support them. All right, without much further ado, should I introduce what we did this year, briefly?
Sure.
Or would you like to? Okay. So in the first semester, just to give you a little context, students did projects about immigration and why they moved to this country. And tonight you'll see some digital stories, some short movies they made about that topic. So enjoy those. And then this semester, students are doing some social justice research projects. And they'll be presenting some speeches that we hope will move you to take action and make some changes in our community. Thanks again for being here. Josh?
And I'll be very brief, other than to say, can we give a big round of applause for Miss Julie Casper for all this effort?
Let us begin with the first half of the readings and digital stories. The first person we're going to start off is Zamzam.
But before I do, let me give you a little background about this poem. This poem relates to a question that I've been asked when I was getting an interview that for a scholarship that I've recently received. One of the interviewers asked me why I love to write poetry, because I was nervous at the time, and I did not say all I wanted to say. Now that I have another chance, let me tell you why. Why I write. I write for me. I write to put myself at ease. I write for those women who carried the world's burden on their shoulder. I write for my mother and all the Somali mothers who stood hours and hours in immigration lines so we wouldn't have to. I write for those who are grateful. I write for those bitten black and blue who every womb tell untold story of success. I write because I once lived in a place where speaking of justice was forbidden. I write because I want to be a change of tomorrow. I write because I'm tired of separation. I write because I want all of us to be united. I write because my motherland is known as the nation of poets, and I was taught to write poetry at the age of 6. I write because some fight with bullets, while others fight with their legs, but I fight with my words. I write because that's the only way I get my message across. Thank you.
I recognize the presence of my principal, Mr. Scott. My fellow teachers, and fellow students. Invited guests. Parents. Ladies and gentlemen, good evening. My name is John Juma, and I'm from South Sudan. And I would like to share my story with you back from Africa before moving to the United States of America. I hope you will enjoy it. I knew that one day I will move to a special place like America. But before we moved to the US, first we immigrated to Kenya. Living in Kenya was like a gift to me, but a gift that was filled with pains and joy at the same time. The country was beautiful, with beautiful people and awesome views. I remember walking with friends, having fun, and swimming in the river. Since I moved to the US, I miss Kenya a lot, and all my friends whom we live together. I have a wish that one day I will meet all my friends again. As all the people say, mountain cannot move, but as people we move from place to place. At first, I didn't know why we left our home country, Sudan. I was very young, and even if my aunt told me, I can't remember anything. When we got to the US, we lived for 2 to 3 months, and things became very difficult to my aunt and I. I had no friends, nowhere to go, and then I asked my aunt about why we left Sudan. My aunt answered, "Son, we should give thanks to God because he brought us to America." I said, "Aunt, I still do not understand you." Then she said, "Okay." And on that day, she told me what had happened in Sudan and the reason why we came to America today. She said the reason was because of our grandfather. He was a chief. According to our culture and traditions, when things happen or it is going to happen, in time of drought, where when people need rain in the village, the villager have to gather in his compound for the offering that were used to bring rain. And also it was his responsibility to select the young energetic youth to join the army as he was ordered by the government. Then as this continued, those youths end up dying in the front war. The villager became very angry because of their children who joined the army when they are very young and end up dying. One day the government ordered him to select other youths. As he went to families, they all turned against him that they will no longer give their children. When he noticed the government that the villager refused to give their children, the government sent some soldiers and they jailed him that he had a link with the government of Khartoum. One of our family members was caught, brutally tortured, that is to tell where the rest of the family are. He refused and he was killed as we had the news. We decided to move out of the country and we made it to Kenya, where we became refugee for 10 years. Through our prayers and God's help, we got the resettlement to the United States. Now that I'm safe, I look forward to continue with my education till high level. Ladies and gentlemen, one more. Thanks for having taking your time to listen to my story. God bless you.
Hi, everybody.
Hi.
Okay, my name is Jumpin. I'm here to talking about my culture. Okay. Do you know my culture? I come from China. China has one of the oldest culture in the world. That's why some people in China are thinking in the old way, such as thinking a boy is important than the girls. There are many different aspects of the Chinese culture. For example, food, religion, language, and art. Chinese New Year is the most important holiday in China. Also, it is the longest holiday. Chinese New Year begins on the first day of the lunar calendar. So it is also called Lunar New Year. The Chinese New Year is the chance to leave the problem behind, and it is important to start a new year fresh. And this means cleaning up the house and buying new clothes. It also a chance to let the family meet together, they can eat together, and solve the problem that they have. Red is the most important color in Chinese New Year. Many people will wear the red clothes during the New Year celebration, and the house will have many red decorations, such as Chinese work and or the Chinese bombs next to the door. Also, the older people will give us the red emerald during the Chinese New Year, and the red emerald usually to give it the children and I'm very adult. Thank you.
Hi, ladies and gentlemen.
Hi.
I'm Alex. I'm from China, and I'm going to introduce my digital story, and I hope you enjoy it. Thanks.
Immigrant to the United States. China has become one of the most highly developed economies in the world. China's potential is unlimited, but there are many factors that make many Chinese people want to immigrate to the United States. These factors include education, work, and social pressures.
To start, the U.S. has education is better than the Chinese system. When we were studying in China, the education was difficult for us. We had 50 to 60 students in each class with 800 students in each grade level. The best school admits students only with high test scores, and we would only agree that 700 students could enroll. The teacher could not pay attention to each student. There was too much pressure. That stone on the back of students. It made us feel tired of school. We didn't have time to play soccer or anything that we want to do. We had to study 9 subjects every year because we would have an important test when we conclude grade 9. The test for each subject was about what we learned in 3 years of middle school, and the test was very hard. Our math skills are very good in here because of the tough Chinese education. Math class in China are very hard. The test makes students feel like they had a mountain right on their body. They had to go to school to study by ourselves after dinner until 9 p.m. Sometimes we still didn't finish the homework, and we had to keep going for it. Also, everyone had the same plan for study, the same subjects. We couldn't show our personal individuality. We think personal individuality is very important for everyone. If everyone is the same in our world, that is not interesting.
Secondly, jobs in the United States are better than in China. There are 1.3 billion people in China. It is too competitive, so sometimes it is difficult to find a good job in China. About 27% of university students have difficulty finding a job after graduation. About 83% of university students do find job, but it is usually very low wage. Some university students just can earn $400 to $600 per month. The prices of things are not as expensive like in the United States, but something like house are very expensive for us. Many people don't have enough money to buy house or apartment, and so they rent an apartment. Also, working conditions are harder than in the United States.
Finally, US society is also better than Chinese society. In Chinese society, there are still many crimes like theft. When you go outside, you need to be very careful to take care of your stuff. Chinese society looks stable and nice. In fact, you see in a bus, many young people give the seat to the older or disabled people or to children. The cars and buses obey the traffic rules. People are very friendly. If you stay in China for a little while, you will see some bad things. China has many corrupt officers and the bureaucracy is not good. Some people are very poor in some places. All money goes in a corrupt officer's wallet, so people are still poor. Sometimes a person needs help, but another don't always come to help him. Maybe sometimes somebody will call a policeman, but not too many people will do that. And the hospital officers will not be serious. If some people are poor, the hospital will disregard them. If a person is rich, they will take care of them very carefully. So, we think Chinese society is not good. Everybody wants a good life in the future. Chinese work, education, and social situation still have challenges that are very difficult to solve. The anti is why Chinese people feel their life is toilsome. In our opinion, a better life depends to live with comfort and freedom. Because of this, many Chinese want to immigrate to the United States.
Marshall Island.
We're gonna introduce our video about our country, Marshall Island. Please enjoy.
Marshall Islanders are no threat to the Pacific and the world for their friendly and peaceful nature. Cooperation and caring are necessary elements of survival on the islands surrounded by the sea. Marshall Island is a small place where a lot of different people come to spend their vacation. Marshall Island is a good place for summer vacation because it has a nice and clean beach to swim and to go for a walk. You can also see all the sun changes colors at night. This is not the only reason why Marshall Islands is a good place to be. There is so much sharing with family and friends. A warm welcome for the strangers and caring consideration for others are values inherent to the Marshallese culture.
Some of the Marshallese, like our family, immigrated to the U.S. because they wanted their kids to have a better education and a better life for their family. People in the Marshall Islands sometimes wish to stay, but they don't have enough money to afford clothes because employers pay very little, so many Marshallese don't have enough money to support their families. Almost 36% of the people don't have jobs in Marshall Island. The electricity is always cutting off, and they wouldn't have light for a whole week until it's fixed. When the electricity is off, people use neither candles or flashlights to light their house. Life in the Marshall Islands is hard because the economy is low. Some of them immigrated here for their family to go to a sanitized hospital and because of the bad pollution. It's hard for Marshallese to look for a job back at the Marshall Islands because there are not that many jobs for people to make money. Part of the Marshall Islands is full of Chinese people, and it is like most of the jobs there. When people move from the Marshall Islands, more Chinese come. Almost the entire population of the islands is full of Chinese people.
Women back at the small islands sometimes make their own budget by making crafts and selling them. That way they have enough money to provide food for their family for a month. They thought of coming to the U.S. to look for jobs and a better education. Parents brought their kids to go to school, unlike the schools here in the U.S. Students come to the U.S. so they can learn English and send money for their families back in the Marshall Islands. Another reason is because the parents want their children to grow up in a different country and for them to have a better education so they can support the Marshall Islands and make changes for our country.
For us, we want to finish high school, go to college, and then go back to the Marshall Islands. Our goals are to make the Marshall Islands a clean environment, a better place to learn, and the best place to be.
So I wrote an essay about accepting a new culture, so here we go. The most difficult situation I've encountered in my life is being able to accept and combine both American and European cultures together. I was born in Croatia and came to the United States with my family when I was 7 years old. However, my parents wanted to come here because they wanted us to have a better life, education, and employment. I was taught by my parents to only accept one culture. Both my parents have strong traditional beliefs and values. Some of the values and beliefs my parents have are things like sitting down with the family and having dinner together, and believing in St. Nicholas, which is an Orthodox god. They also decorate the kitchen table with fruit, nuts, corn, candles, bread, and a roasted pig representing the harvest season in Europe, and placing a basket of hay under the table with the same contents for St. Nicholas to take on his journey. These events all happen when it's time to ring in the new year. I can understand that the main reason my parents are teaching my siblings and I these values and beliefs is so that the cultural traditions will continue in our family. Moving to another country and learning another culture while maintaining this home culture hasn't been easy. My parents weren't very thrilled about my siblings and I being exposed to another culture. The reason they didn't approve was because it wasn't the European culture or traditions that we grew up with as young children. I realized that early on how different my own culture was from the American culture. My first experience with celebrating Halloween was different. I didn't understand the meaning of the holiday or even how it was celebrated. So I took matters into my own hands and I looked in history books for more information about the holiday. I talked with my friends and even learned about the holiday in school. The information I found was very interesting. My parents never discouraged me from participating in activities or holiday celebrations at school. However, my personal life was quite different. At home, Halloween Day was a normal day for us because we didn't have anything special happening, so we continued to do what we prepared to do that day. At my house, it's very traditional when it comes to Croatian customs, because even though I learned American customs, I didn't mean I stopped studying about my own culture. Learning a new language was another challenging experience. My parents didn't approve my siblings and I speaking English in the house because it was a European household. They insisted we speak Serbo-Croatian because they wanted to understand what we were talking about, but they also didn't want to feel left out of the conversation. At my school, teachers and friends were teaching me things that I could benefit from. In order for me to succeed in school, I needed to learn English and be able to understand what was going on around me. Even though I have parents who disagree with me on some points about cultures, I know that in the end I can accept the American culture to be part of my European culture because this is my new home now, and I know that I'm part of this new culture. I've learned that it's important to communicate with my parents about my old life and how we lived, but it's also important to talk about the life we are living in now. Thank you.
My name is Michelle Nabi. I'm from Afghanistan, and I'm going to read you guys a poem that I wrote. Sitting in my darkness, waiting for a light to strike me, waiting for a hand to pull me out, not afraid of darkness, but afraid of sitting in my own loneliness. Friends left me, family abandoned me, and my dreams turned to nightmare, left me stranded in that situation. By myself, a hand I'm handed, success what I get, it was demanded. At the end, I have myself to keep, to trust and to keep on rock, so I don't need anyone but me and I and myself to pull me out. Thank you.
Hey everybody, my name is Mariana. I wrote a speech about bullying, but we were writing speeches, but everybody like chose like world hunger or like war or like guns or drugs, but I chose bullying because it was connected to me. So here it goes. Speak out. My name is Mariana Klipik, and I was a victim of verbal bullying. I used to get bullied. I used to get bullied in elementary school because I didn't know how to speak English, write, or even read it. Other students told me I didn't belong here in the United States just because I was from a different country. Even the teachers would treat me differently from other students. They also judged me because I didn't dress like a girl. I was more of a tomboy, you can say. Yeah. When other students in my class told me these things, I felt like I didn't belong here. I also felt different from other people. What really hurt me the most is when they told me I didn't belong here. That really affected me tremendously in my life in elementary school. I want to ask you these three simple questions. Have you ever experienced bullying? Have you ever been a bully yourself? And have you ever thought about telling somebody about the problem? First of all, there's many types of bullying out there in the world. For example, cyberbullying, verbal bullying, school bullying, workplace bullying, and name calling.
Bullying is so dangerous, many people around the world are affected by it. Some victims are humiliated, threatened, judged, and the victims also get horribly injured in the event. Some even commit suicide in their life. When this situation happens, nobody comes to give a helping hand. The reason for that is because their friends don't want to fall for as a victim. There are so many young adults out there in the world who are victims, even who were victims but no longer here with us and their families. For example, like Amanda Todd, she committed suicide on October 10, 2012. Amanda's from British Columbia, Canada. She was only 15 years old when she died because of cyberbullying. Do you really want this to happen to your child? If not, it's time to make a change in this world. Let's stand together as a community and family. Here are some ways you can take action. You can talk to a counselor, teacher, mom, or dad. The most important thing is to tell somebody if you don't, things can turn horribly wrong and they can even turn into a nightmare. Now is the time to help our people, schools, organization, and our nation. Thank you.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Emmanuel Logo, and I'm from Bantu Eritrea in East Africa by the Red Sea. Today I want to share with you guys my digital story that we met in Ms. Casper class for finding my voice. And it's about why my family and I left my homeland, and I hope one day this political conflict will be solved. So enjoy the video. Thank you.
I had a bullet in my leg. I faced a lot of problems in my life. I'm from Bantu Eritrea in East Africa by the Red Sea. The dictator government didn't give people freedom, which is why Eritrean people left their homeland. Getting education is hard for people in Eritrea. First of all, it's really hard to study in my country, because you have to be at school all day and there is no free food in school to eat. We had to bring our own food or we paid money to eat at school. Additionally, if we came to class late, the teachers might hit the students with stick on their butt or on their hand. I used to cry a lot when they hit me. Finally, the teachers didn't care about the students. They just wanted the money. They didn't teach the students well, and some teachers were disrespectful to students. That's why I didn't have a good education or chance to learn. Another problem we faced was that we had no idea how to find jobs there. My parents and other Eritrean parents didn't have good jobs to get a lot of money. Thus, they didn't have money to feed us. And sometimes we went to school without breakfast or we slept without dinner. In my country, people try to grow their own foods like in their garden to eat or sell to people to get money, like sugarcane, sesame oil, and milk. Some people work as servants for the rich, but most Eritreans don't always get what they want to get for their family. We come here because of these problems and because of political conflict. There was too much war going on in my country between 1998 and 2000. When the teenagers turn 17 or 18, the government would come to the house to take the teens to the military. Even if they hid under the bed, they would check every room. I lost a lot of my family in the war because Eritrea fought with Ethiopia for many years over land. Eritrean leaders wanted to rule the people, the land, and the area of Ethiopia. Most people immigrate because of bad experience, like war and lack of jobs, just like my family. It's hard to find freedom in every country. Knowing how we or your friends came to America is an important thing. I appreciate all of you listening to my digital story so you can know why I came to America.
And this is my last year finding my voice, and I wrote this little poetry, and I hope you guys love it. And it's called Distance. Anyways. All right. Distance may cause maidens of tears. It may also bring fear. If our love is clear, it will never disappear. Whether we are far or near, we will always persevere. For with a love deep and sincere, we will always be each other's peers. My love, I love you. No matter the distance in quill, no one can split us in two. Even if our time together are few, I miss your kisses. No one else in this world will do. Thought of you are not in view. In my mind and heart, there is only you. I miss your love. I want you to feel it too. So together we can make it through. To look back one day and see how time flew.
My name is Joanna. I'm from Liberia, and the story I'm going to read, oh, it's a poem, isn't it? It's a long-distance poem. Your love may seem far, the day may seem gloomy. The night are cold and lonely, times pass by slowly. When I can see you daily, I still think of you constantly. Looking in your eyes, telling you that you mean the world to me. I miss you. I miss your kisses so terribly. Without you, life seems so empty. I can't look forward lonely to all your hugs and kisses, especially. I love you. Don't matter the distance between us. Nothing can split us apart from each other. Even though I can't see your face, I can't see you face to face. You are always on my mind. I wish to see you even more, my love. Together, we can make the greatest thing last forever. To look back one day and see how time's by. And time passed by. Can't wait for that day to come so I can see that smile on your face. I miss you, love.
Namaskar and good evening to everyone. My name is Kedar. Today I'm standing up you to share my digital story which we made in Miss Casper class. This movie made by me and my friend Robin. This story about our refugee life and how we immigrate from Bhutan to Nepal to survey. And how we pass the 20 years as Bhutanese refugee in Nepal. I'm so proud to be here to share my digital story with you and hope you all enjoy with my movie. Thank you.
Why have many Bhutanese and the Nepalese people come to Hivar Sishanji? Bhutan is more than a land of country. It is located in Asia between China and India. It is surrounded by mountains and green forests. In Bhutan, there are no big cities, but there are beautiful valleys. Bhutan has a good farming land and a good environment and climate. So why have the people left their homeland of Bhutan?
As early as 1620, the first Nepalese arrived in Bhutan. Our ancestor settled there in 1880s from Nepal. During the late 19th century, the Burmese government began to organize the settlement of Nepali-speaking people. By 1930, about 60,000 Nepali people had settled and were working in Bhutan. Our grandparents were from Bhutan. Our fathers, mothers were on a farm in Bhutan. There are so many animals, horses, cows, goats, hens, and more. This animal made it easier for farmer. Our lives went smoothly and fine there, but the government of our country, Bhutan, started a civil war by discriminating against our language, religion, caste, culture. We had to wear Buddhist clothes, get poor education, and be dominated. The government made it is impossible to get to school for our education because school was so far away.
We were the first to speak a Dzongkha language when we really want to speak native. We had to wear a Bhutanese coat when we want to wear a Nepalese coat. Men had to wear a coat and gear up our horns. We had to wear this coat in office when we went to the market and our place. Inside the Bhutan, all the people are required to speak in Dzongkha language. It was difficult for our grandfather and grandmother to speak the same like other people. When they went to the market, they had to speak in Dzongkha language to other people.
Furthermore, there was discrimination because of religion in our community. There were different types of religions celebrated by people. There were Buddhist, Christian, and Hindu in the community. Most of the people followed the Buddhist and Hindu religion. Half of them followed Christian religion inside Bhutan. They discriminated against each other by comparing their religion and saying one is higher than the others. Also, there were discrimination because of culture. We had to celebrate the same culture in our community. There were people who wore masks and drupa dress. They chose drama with related to Buddhist culture, song, dance, not our Nepali culture. There was also a problem about education in the country. We had to walk a very long distance to reach school. There were not enough facilities like transportation. We had to go by ourselves, walking far away from home. There were also not enough facilities inside the classroom. There were no desks. We had to put carpet on the floor and sit on the ground. There were not enough computers for our parents or us to study and learn from the internet. In addition, there were strong law and regulation for students to follow inside the school. The teachers were treating the students like animals. For example, if students didn't do their homework, then the teachers would give a horrible punishment to students. Teachers beat students if they didn't do their homework or if they didn't wear regular Burmese school dress. Teachers give strong punishment to them like making students bend up and down on the wall. Sometimes students have to bend down and put their leg up and stand like that for a full period.
Because of problems of religion, language, culture and education, it has become impossible for some people to stay in Bhutan. This is why so many Bhutanese have to leave Bhutan and flee to the refugee camp in Nepal. After 20 years in that camp and many more struggles, many Bhutanese came to here. Now we are in America. We have a lot of chance to get knowledge, to study in a good school, get good job, and better life.
Those are really wonderful stories, and let's welcome all the Somali dancers to perform their cultural Somali dance.
Thank you. dance and we all enjoy it. And time for the second part of the reading, and I want to introduce the additional story by Anas, Abby, and Kadra.
Sorry, Kadra.
Hi, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Anas Ali. I'm from Somalia, and we made a digital story, and I have my partners right here.
And I'm Abdi Bele, and I'm sophomore.
Hello, my name is Tamara Isaac, and I'm also a sophomore. I hope you guys like something about the movie. Thank you.
Somalia gained independence on July 1st, 1960 from Iran, but it has struggled in the civil war. Even though there is fighting, Somalia is a beautiful country with the rivers, beaches, and trees. Also, there are many fresh foods and different types of food. The people there are welcoming, and everyone in the neighborhood treats each other as a family.
Since 1991, the civil war has been ongoing. Millions of Somali citizens have been killed by rebels. Al-Shabaab means the youth in Arabic. That's the name of the most dangerous group in Somalia. They kill people because they do not like the government. They do not want to bring peace into the country. The war officially began in 1991. The fight has gotten more dangerous.
Between January 1991 and August 2000, Somalia had no working government. The president fled the country in 1990 with no leadership. Al-Shabaab and remaining government officials started fighting. The economy went down because of the war. Al-Shabaab was burning the crops and livestock. That is one reason the economy suffered. Also, people who had knowledge or professional kids left Somalia because of the fighting. So there were no people to work and make the economy stronger.
There are so many reasons, like the political and economic reasons described already, why Somalians have immigrated to the United States. One additional reason we have immigrated is because there is no really good education opportunity. Some of the Somali people had to pay money for their children to go to school, but they couldn't because they have no jobs. Half of the Somali people are rich and poor in the poor ones. Some families are so poor that they make their children work at home, so they rarely have time for school. That is why a lot of Somalians who came to the United States don't speak any English. The government was not doing a good job with the student education. Our parents think education is very important, but they just don't have any money to pay for the school, and that is one reason why we left Somalia.
In conclusion, these are the main reasons Somali people immigrated from their home country. This is everything that happened and still going on. We immigrate for a reason, not without a reason. There's no way Somali people will go back until there's a peace and no war. Do you think anyone would want to live in a country and war? Can you imagine how it would be to live in a place like that? Life was just too hard. That's why we moved and looked for a peaceful place where there's no war.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen.
My name is Benji Bolisia. I'm from the Democratic Republic of Congo. Today, I would like to share my opinion about war in the world. There it goes. The worst humanitarian war in the world continues in the whole of Africa. Today, 1 million people are dying during the war. What should we do as a community to help the world? During war, we see children getting their lungs blown off by a bomb, becoming uneducated, experiencing the emotional toll on soldiers as young adults. Why war? According to the World Child Organization, there are horrible physical effects of war on children. What grabs the headline is children being killed and maimed by the bombs and beats of war. But some of these children are equipped to become soldiers themselves and are placed directly in the firing line. There are 250,000 child soldiers in the world, and 40% of child soldiers are girls. Rape and sexual violence are increasingly being used as a weapon of war. Many girls and young women have babies as a result or are hurt in such a way that they cannot have children in the future. Many more children die or become gravely injured from the indirect physical effects of war. Hospitals and health centers are destroyed. Doctors and nurses are killed or have fled. Children are most vulnerable to diseases like diarrhea, malaria, and cholera. Treatment is simple and cheap, but millions of children have died through lack of it. War destroys industries, jobs, and infrastructure. Many people are sure that any war is unfair and should be stopped as it brings only harm and damage. People are losing their homes, relatives, and millions of innocent people are dying. There is a huge difference between what you know and what you feel in your heart. What do you feel about those people dying around the world? What do you think about those children raised without education? What do you feel about those people who are hungry and living without food when we are wasting food every day? What action should you take to save people's lives around the world? This is not time for us to relax, stay calm, or slowly think of a solution when others are dying, suffering during the war. Think about your life here and that of other children in the world, countries. Why God nation have to suffer into this level? It is time to take real action. It is time to find peace in the world. It is time to bring love between countries. And it is time to lift our hand and pray for peacefulness in the world. Together we can help people get back on their feet during this time of war around the world. I believe that everyone has a solution. We should put ourselves into this situation and think about what others are passing through, and then understand each other. Thank you for listening.
Many companies are closing in Mexico because the economy is falling and many people don't have jobs. The unemployment rate in Mexico is about 5.5% and is increasing more every day. And the underemployment rate may be as high as 25%. People who have just guessed a wage that is too low, about $7 per day. In a lot of cases, the companies don't provide social security and insurance either. The houses are very expensive and others too. The prices for everything are increasing and people can't pay for things that they want. Because there are no jobs and things are very expensive, people are immigrating to the US to have an opportunity and better life.
Now in Mexico, many people sell drugs in school and other places. That is a very bad thing because people are dying using drugs and the government doesn't do anything about it. Also, the drug sellers are killing each other to increase their share of the drug market and to gain more power. It is very dangerous for people in Mexico. They are scared of the bad people. In many cases, the bad people start to fight and shoot against each other in public streets. You have to sell drugs and make money, and this causes violence. This is another reason why people immigrate to the U.S. from Mexico.
Mexican moms and dads also bring their families to the U.S. so they can have a better education. In Mexico, parents have to pay each semester for high school. It's very expensive, and not all parents can support it. Then the students have to drop out of high school. When their parents don't have to work, they immigrate here because they know the USA is a country with a lot of opportunity. High school is free, the economy is stronger, and the goods are cheap.
Those are the reasons why people from Mexico can't have a Mexican dream, and the reason why we have to search for the American dream. Even though we love our country, we sometimes are obligated to leave our country. It is not only for our future and security. We also have to look for wealth for the future of our families and people that we love.
And the president of Finding My Ways, Mrs. Julia Cosper. I wrote this story about my life plans and I'm going to read it. I'm from Afghanistan and I came here in March 2011. I am a student at Catalina Magnet High School and I am going to graduate from high school in 2013. I have many goals that I have not yet accomplished. First, I must pass my writing skills comprehension. Second, I have to pass my reading skills comprehension. The third one is the hardest one, which called in math. After that, my plan is to go to college for 3 years to get ready and to give me some energy to go to the University of Arizona. Thank you. My goal is to be a doctor to take care of sick people, which in my country we have a lot of patients, but we do not have doctors to help sick people. I also want to help the people who don't have many animals, who live under the tunnels in the cold weather of winter while they don't have any blankets to protect their body from the sun or from the cold weather. Some of them leave their family because of being poor and having not money. Some of them leave their family because of the job, and they go to the another country to bring back home some money to take care of their home kids. I also have some knowledge of history of Afghanistan. I am very sad to remind that. But I also understand that some women in Afghanistan are treated with coarseness by their husband or by their husband's family. In some cases, even the home wife suddenly killed herself or got killed by her husband. Everyone knows this is because of marrying the people who doesn't know who is he or who is she. Usually when they are married, they don't understand anything about each other. There is a lot of compulsory marriage in our country that doesn't have any happiness in their future. In conclusion, my plan to my future is going to be extremely improving, which is somewhat helpful for those who are indigent and institute with which is probably very hard to tell in front of everyone. I have to get my GED diploma that will help me to go to college for 3 years. After that, I will go to the University of Arizona to become a nurse to work with the doctor in obstetrics job. In the end, I also want to be very loyal to my work with the professional people who make a better community to build the growth of the economy for their country and their people. Thank you.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Anas. I would like to share with you today the importance of education, a speech about the importance of education. Can you believe more than 57% of children in the world are not getting education today? I know we have the lack time to get free education. I'm here because I want to talk to you about your education, your future, what is expected from all of us. We have schools and teachers who are pushing us to learn something. The responsibility that you have is to do your homeworks, not to spend your time on Facebook or on TV. Yes. Your government is here trying to give you enough education, which some other countries are not getting it today. You are the future. You are the future. You need to put a lot of pressure on it. You need to put a lot of pressure on it. The responsibility that each one of us have is to study. Every step that you took is to study. Now, every one of us right here is skillful at something and their impact of something. Maybe you want to be a good writer. Maybe even good enough to write a book or good enough to write a newspaper. But you might not know until you write that English paper. No matter what you do with your life, I will guarantee you without education, you will not have a bright future. You want to be a doctor, a pilot, a lawyer, or a nurse. You need to get education for it. Every step you take, there must be education in it. You can drop out of school and drop into good job. You get to learn for it, study for it, train for it. And it is not only important for you, it is also important for your future, for your people, and for your country too. The future of your country are depending on you. You, what you are learning today in the school, they all will determine for the future on you. And now I just want to give you some advice. Like now, we are the nation. We have to work for it. We have to develop like something that we can kill with cancers. And we have to work for our nations to give them a good environment. We need every single of us to develop something for the citizens can have a bright future. To solve, we need to solve for the coming future most of their problems. You can't just drop out of, you can't just quit school. If you quit school, you're not just quitting for yourself, you're quitting also for your country and for your people. Thanks for listening.
Hi everybody, tonight I'm talking about the Refugee Youth Coalition. My name is Issam Ali. I'm a student at Carolina Magnet High School. I'm a youth leader for Refugee Youth Coalition. The Refugee Youth Coalition is a group of activists who are creative, intelligent, supportive, thoughtful, and hardworking. The mentor and education and social action will solve problems and be a strong community for the refugee. The RYC cooperates with agents and families and friends for employment. We have education and social action group and mentoring. And each group, they have a leadership. And then we make the presentation about high school students, how they help the refugees coalition, and then they meet twice a week. and then please, if you want to get more information, please go to Facebook and type it www.refugees. www.refugeescoalition.com, and then you can get more information. And then last week we did a presentation at Carolina Magnet High School in Miss Riley, her room, lunchtime. Thank you, and please enjoy this community.
Okay, I'm Florence Lee, and I'm going to read you what Bomari says. Get up, stand up, stand up for your right. Get up and stand up, and don't give up your fight, says Bomari. This quote means to me that no matter what you try to achieve, don't let anyone push you around or stop you. Just get up, keep trying. People may humiliate you, are also not listening to you, but you still have to try and sing. Just stand up, look them in the eyes and tell them that you are not afraid of them. This quote is important to me because sometimes people would do anything to see you underground, but when you decide not to stand up on your own and choose not to give up, they will be surprised with sometimes I feel like I'm shy, which I am. To other people know how I feel and what I'm hoping to achieve, but I have to fight for my dream and what I want. I agree with Scott because there are people who like to see you down and giving up your dreams and your hopes, but they won't help you to get up on your feet. Some people from my country will sit back and watching you giving up your dreams and your hope. Some of my friends will enjoy seeing their friends holding and struggling, but they won't help them. However, there will be a time you will be tired of people who try to tell you not to achieve your dreams. So you will give up and stand up for your right. Don't give up until you reach your goal or whatever. Tell the world who you want to be and what you try to achieve in your life. Thank you.
To knock the doors of your heart. Today I'm here with a short poem. Hi everyone, my name is Dawzan Magar. I'm from Bhutan. I've been here for almost 16 months and today I'm here with a short poem. I hope you guys would love it. If you can stand again after falling down so many times, then you still have a hope. If you can accept one more challenge after losing so many times, then you still have a hope. If you can make your own way when every trial is blocked for you, then you still have a hope. If you can smile for a second when your world is full of grief, then you still have a hope. If you have ability to figure out your weakness and have power to make it your strength, then you still have a hope. Hope is belief, hope is life, hope is the courage to do something right. So never lose your hope. Thank you.
Obviously, some of you do know that we do have a fashion show, but before I start talking, Mr. Rex Scott wants to say a couple of words or introduce somebody.
Thank you, Zelka, for letting me interrupt. I was remiss at the beginning of our ceremony when I did not introduce somebody who has been for the longest time one of the great cheerleaders and promoters of Catalina. And he is here with us tonight as he had been with us many nights to help us tell our story. And as usual, he is behind his camera. Please give a big hand from TUSD Telecommunications, Mr. Jeff Spruvalcaba!
Our models are getting preparing for our show. I want to say a couple words about the trip that we took early on this year. It was in March 9th, and it was a trip to Grand Canyon. The trip was based on basically learning about Grand Canyon, how it was formed, and just learning about nature and its life and animals. But it was also about the students and them being able to learn new vocabulary and just kind of stretch themselves, and we took them to, we did take them to Grand Canyon, but we wanted them to experience something new and a new environment, so we took them to Grand Canyon, and we were required to keep a journal. That's basically what we learned, and the fossils that we learned about, and the rock ages, but it was just based upon education, but it was also about based upon just learning and having fun and just exploring nature. So I don't know what else to say.
Thank you to all of our donors for
supporting. Thank you to all of our donors. And if you haven't purchased a book yet, 2003, it is $8. You are contributing, obviously, to a great cause, and you make next year's publication possible by donating. So if you guys haven't, you can purchase one at the end of the show. So, yeah.
Do you want to peek and see if they're ready?
Yeah.
Ooh, thank you to Ms. Casper.
Yeah, thanks.
All right, so here it is again.
welcome all the ELD teachers to give awards to their outstanding students. Let's welcome them. Their outstanding student. Okay? So they're going to present those awards, and after they do that, I'm also going to recognize all of the seniors who are here who presented this evening. Okay? It's Jenny Mack will start.
Thank you. And the next award is for Nina Garaway.
It's the greatest pleasure of an educator to recognize students, and it's, we only wish we could recognize every student for all the things that they've brought to our lives. Tonight, I would like to recognize from my class, Nazia Romero.
She's not here.
There was an emergency, she had to leave.
Okay. Yeah. I'll hold this for Nazia, I'll see her tomorrow, I'm sure.
And now if Mary Cassidy could join me, we'd like to quickly recognize all of our Finding Voice seniors who presented tonight or are participating tonight, and there are many of you. So what I'm going to ask is I'm going to call your name. I'm going to ask you guys to line up, and Ms. Cassidy is going to present you with your certificate, and we'll applaud for everyone at the end. The first Finding Voice Senior Award goes to Patricia Cole. And the next is to Soraya Fazia. And the next Finding Voice Senior Award goes to Trizer Furasi. And the next award goes to Harina Hassan. And the next award goes to Zamzam Percy. And the next senior award goes to Zhangping Huang. And the next Finding Voice Senior Award goes to Purna Kathy. Big shout out to our ladies who are up there. Hi Purna, hi Phelan, thank you. Congratulations. Our next award goes to Finding Voice Senior Joanna Keita. And the next one goes to Annette Keju. Our next Finding Voice Senior is Rihanna Clippett. And our next Finding Voice Senior is her twin, Zelda Clippett. Finding Voice Senior, that was Amagar, congratulations. I'd like to recognize Marcel Nabi, congratulations. And one of our MCs, Ms. Neha Priyanali. Congratulations as well. And Bambi and Jibu, Finding Voice Senior, come on up. And Kagendra Suveni, can you come out from behind the curtain to receive your award? There he is. Congratulations to our seniors. These wonderful students are leading us to do incredible things.
Big round of applause.